Solomon's Vegas Adventures.
What's going on, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Solomon's Vegas Adventures. Today we're going to explore Owl Canyon, a nice slot canyon out by Lake Mead. So without further ado, let's go.
So this canyon is known as White Owl Canyon by some and Owl Canyon by others, but honestly, the semantics don't really matter. Either way, the hike is located out at Lake Mead, so you're going to have to pay a fee to get in unless you have a National Parks Pass. So to get there, just take Lake Mead Parkway out of Henderson all the way, and it'll be a couple miles past the River Mountains entrance. To the left at a place called 33 Hole Parking Lot.
Alright y'all, we are here at Owl Canyon on another episode of Solomon's Vegas Adventures. So for starters, from the parking lot, you come down a really steep hill. You can see these terraces and the bluffs around here. That's where the water level used to be at different points in time. At full capacity, water level was all the way up to the parking lot almost. That parking lot was a boat ramp. It ebbed and it flowed and it eventually got lower and lower and lower until it's over there. There's lots of shells, zebra mussels from when this was underwater. Now the lake is way over there. Tragedy. So this is Owl Canyon. Going in the back of it. Let's go. Well, things are starting to get interesting now. They'll get even more interesting soon. The desert is in bloom. Certainly is spring out here.
And with life comes death. This head of a sparrow. Maybe it was eaten by one of those owls in Owl Canyon.
It's really cool to see all these layers of alluvium and how they were compacted and lithified over time to form these deposits that would eventually be eroded by mainly water, but also a little bit of wind into this canyon.
'Tis now starting to get more interesting. That right there is a nice fault. Normal fault right there. You can see the hanging wall is going down relative to the footwall. Pretty minor, but you know, just more of that evidence of Great Basin extensional tectonism. It's a couple feet of offset right here, so you can tell. And I wonder if this fault's still active. This is the opposite side of the canyon, and you can see that it kind of cuts the canyon, but I don't think it's active anymore because it doesn't cut the wash, the alluvium. Now, ain't that a view? We're going further and further into the slot canyon here at Owl Canyon. This is really cool. As you guys can see, this gets pretty narrow up here. This seems like a nice place for shelter during rain, until you realize that you're in the path of a wash and you'll probably be flash flooded out. Still cool though. Just want you guys to see something. They don't call this Owl Canyon for no reason. If you look right up there, that's a bunch of owl droppings. And this canyon is littered with it, so there are some nests for some owls in this canyon.
Hence the name.
Ooh, this is a nice little area. Lots of owl droppings up there. They probably live in the little grottos up there. But we're gonna keep going. This is really cool. This is so cool. More evidence of owls in the canyon. Those are their feathers from their nest and some of the prey that they ate. And the canyon continues past the road. You get to go in here. Under the road, further up the canyon. Let's go. Into the tunnel we go. Ooh, that echo though, this is crazy. This is like a nice optical illusion for you guys. Well, I don't even know if it's an optical illusion, but like, it's trippy, it makes my head hurt. On to the other side.
Another set of tunnels.
Into the tunnel, shaped like a funnel.
Whoa. Damn, that echo though. Really nice view in the back of the canyon, but before I get too roped into all the geology, we're going to turn around and go to the lake. But after visiting the lake, you guys should be sure to stick around for a geology talk. I'm going to give you a geology talk. I did it in the field. Solomon's Vegas Adventures.
Great views at the mouth of the canyon. Muddy mountain over there.
Look at these really cool veins of gypsum here. Wow.
Dope.
More of that gypsum, aka hydrous calcium sulfate, CaSO4 times 2H2O. Pay attention in chemistry, kids.
It's like a little inlet.
Yeah, watch where you're walking right here.
Water down there.
There's gypsum everywhere here. Whoa. The amount of gypsum here is astounding. This entire embankment is just made of gypsum. Holy cow.
And there's the lake. Wetlands over there. Lake Mead over there. The water level in Lake Mead fluctuates with the seasons. Water level is higher now because it's spring, and it should get higher the deeper into spring we get into, but look at that. Just great views. This hike really has it all. Owl Canyon.
Look at that very large
white bird. These nice, healthy wetlands.
Oh,
big white bird. Look at these wetlands. That's what she said.
That's something you don't see every day, the sheep range looking like that.
He hears all the birds. Just can't get over the beauty of these wetlands. Wow.
And now, time for a geology talk.
So this rock right here is basalt, and the green that you see, that's a perfect example of olivine. So olivine is a silicate mineral that crystallizes in mafic magmas, which means magmas that are higher temperature and come from deeper in the earth, like the mantle. And olivine is really cool because it's used as a gemstone. And olivine is the first mineral on the Bowen's reaction series, which means that it crystallizes at the highest temperature. So we know that this magma is super hot, or was super hot before it crystallized. So just some evidence of some mantle rock here from, possibly the mantle, but deep within the earth at a high temperature. Associated, of course, with that all-powerful basin and range regional tectonism.
Here's more of that olivine and that basalt, guys. Now, olivine has two main end members, phaolite and forsterite. Phaolite is the iron end member of olivine, Fe2SiO4, and forsterite is the magnesium member of olivine, Mg2SiO4. It's impossible to tell if this is phaolite or forsterite unless I take it to a lab, but most olivine is just a mix of the two anyway.
This is basalt, but there are phenocrysts of pyroxene. That's what those black dots are. Pretty cool.
And then this right here, you see those holes? That's vesicular basalt, which just means that when this magma erupted, there was some gas in it, and the bubbles just pop and leave holes in the rock, which is dope. This specimen sure has a lot of phenocrysts of that pyroxene that I was talking about. Now, I do want to mention, if you're a rock hounder, you can't take any rocks here because we're in the Lake Mead National Recreation Area, so you're not allowed to take any specimens, but you can look and you can see evidence of the active processes of the earth. It's really cool.
So you can see a dichotomy between these volcanic layers in the foreground and those in the background. In the foreground, they're darker, they're more enriched with olivine, they're denser, and in the background, they're lighter in color and lighter in heaviness. And there's a story behind that. So I'll tell you that story.
Oh God, there's bees.
Oh God, there's bees. This is a great view that really highlights the principle of fractional crystallization in geology and especially in petrology. So for starters, there's three main types of magma. There's basalt, there's andesite, and there's rhyolite. And these three different magmas have different characteristics. Basalt is hotter, it has more heavy elements like iron, and it comes from deeper in the earth, and it's considered by geologists to be more primitive, which means that it has less incompatible elements. Now, there are certain elements that are considered incompatible in petrology, and I'll get into that. Now, andesite is kind of middle of the pack. It's not super primitive. It has the iron and magnesium, but it also has silica. It's kind of like a mix. It's a mix. And then rhyolite is considered the most evolved. It is considered the most enriched in incompatible elements like potassium. And rhyolite is very light, and it has a lot of silica in it, so quartz. Now, these different magmas have different processes in how they're created, and there are different conditions in which they erupt. And all three magmas are present in this exact mountain range. So in the foreground, you're looking at basalt, which, you know, comes from deeper in the earth. But in the back, the lighter ridge in the background, that's andesite, and there's rhyolite beyond that even. The basalt units are the oldest volcanic units in this mountain range. The andesite units are the second oldest, they're kind of intermediate, and the rhyolite units are the youngest. Now, it's not a coincidence that basalt is the most primitive of the magmas and rhyolite is the most evolved, and that here basalt is older than rhyolite. So the reasoning for that is that about 20 million years ago, when this area really started to experience that, you know, regional tectonic rifting, which is, you know, colloquially known as the basin and range rifting, you know, magma from the mantle and from deep in the earth came up in this thin section of continental crust, which is what we in Las Vegas, Nevada, parts of Arizona, California, Utah are sitting on. So as this happened, the magma started to erupt. And first, basalt erupted because it came from deep within the earth. And this is where fractional crystallization comes into play. The magma that erupted first did not have time to interact with the continental crust. However, as the igneous body, as the body of magma, continued to be upwelled into the continental crust that was thin here in Nevada, it had more time to interact with that continental crust. And continental crust is made of granite, which is just the intrusive version of rhyolite. Chemically, they're the same. Rhyolite just comes out of volcanoes. Granite has more time to crystallize and is at a higher pressure in the crust. So as the magma interacts with the continental crust here, it takes in some of those incompatible elements in the continental crust, and it becomes more evolved chemically as it's, you know, taking in these evolved elements in the granite. So the rhyolite was the youngest because it had the most time to interact with the continental crust, and it changes its chemical composition as it interacts with the continental crust more. So that's basically just a geologic lesson on the genesis of the igneous bodies and the igneous layers here in the River Mountains and in the Greater Basin and Range Province. And as you guys can see, these volcanic layers are dipped and bounded by faults, by high angle normal faults. And that's not normal. You know, one of the principles of geology is that layers are deposited horizontally unless acted on by an outside force. And the outside force here is a metamorphic core complex. So basically, as the crust extended during the basin and range rifting, this mountain range got cut up by several faults and, you know, bended or dipped, exposing all of the units. And there's one main detachment fault coming from a core of Archean or Proterozoic metamorphic and igneous rock. So that's just a metamorphic core complex. The River Mountains are an example of that. There's plenty of them in the Basin and Range Province. Yep, River Mountains, just a metamorphic core complex. That's why you see all of the different volcanic units, because they've been
extended, dipped, faulted, the whole nine yards.
Look at that discoloration.
Yeah, that's just the oxidation of olivine. So when it's exposed to air, it turns red, like iron. You know, when it's exposed to air, it rusts, turns red. That olivine probably has a lot of iron in it, considering the red oxidation. In this wash, which is entirely alluvial, there's several different rocks that are represented from the river mountains. We've got rhyolite, basalt, and andesite present in this shot, which is exactly what I talked about. This little spiel was 100% off just my memory, so if I got a little details fuzzy, my apologies for that. But yeah, it's just 100% off of what I learned in class in petrology and mineralogy and all that. Shout out to the UNLV Department of Geosciences and Dr. Rodney Metcalf and Dr. Arya Udry for being great professors. And I guess shout out to me for listening. So yeah, that's my geology lesson for today. Thanks for sticking around. I know it was long, I'm sorry. Well, that was Owl Canyon, y'all. This hike really has it all, you know, a slot canyon, really nice geology, and a great lake view. So thanks for tuning in to another episode of Solomon's Vegas Adventures. Please remember to like, comment, and subscribe for more content. Thanks for all the support, y'all. Peace.